Marshall, and I am from the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. And what I'm here today to talk to you a little bit about is we built a multi-site taxonomy plugin in order to cross the boundaries of a WordPress network. So, a little bit about me before we begin. My name is David Marshall, and I work for the School of Public Health. Basically, we're a WordPress shop. The entire website, it runs and is built on WordPress, and we do WordPress development on a day-to-day basis. We build large-scale websites. We have a WordPress network. We run about 2,000 websites on our WordPress network. And on a day-to-day, we build many different plugins, many different themes, and many other WordPress extensions in order to help provide for the faculty and staff of the school. So before we begin, to kind of get everyone here on the same page as to what we're talking about, let's kind of just step through for a minute some basics. WordPress terminology. So taxonomy. Basically, taxonomy is a system of classification inside of WordPress. Most of you are probably familiar with these terms. And it's used to group related content. It's most commonly used for posts in order to group posts into categories and tags. You can also then go ahead and create an unlimited number of taxonomies, depending on what you want, or custom taxonomies within WordPress. There's also tags. Tags are one of the predefined WordPress taxonomies. And they're generally used for posts, and they're generally small keywords that you associate with your post. Being like, when you have a post and you're writing about your ski trip, tags would generally probably be skiing, where you went, and other things associated with how that day was. They are non-hierarchical, and they kind of focus on topics. Categories is the other predefined taxonomy inside WordPress. And that's also used for posts. Categories are hierarchical in nature, and they're generally used as like broad topics. So going back to our ski trip, that if you were blogging about ski trips in general, that would probably be just your one, like a category would be ski trip for that. They generally cover much, much wider focus than tags as well. Now, you have taxonomies, and the items that you put into the taxonomies are then called terms. In WordPress, categories and tags are types of taxonomies, and anything that you put into that is referred to as a term. So when you create your custom taxonomy, you put terms into your custom taxonomy the same way as you put terms into a category or tag. Now, WordPress Multisite. For those of you who haven't used it before or aren't completely familiar with it, WordPress as a traditional blogging platform allows you to create a website. You install WordPress Core, you create one website, you install your themes, you install your plugins, you go from there. You have one site at the end of it. In WordPress Multisite, it was first introduced in 2010 as a way for people to run multiple websites on one WordPress install, further simplifying the whole entire installation. So you have one code base, one set of plugins, one set of themes, one thing to maintain, and you can run a basically unlimited number of websites. Someone that we actually, at the School of Public Health, we have a single WordPress network that's running about 2,000 websites. WordPress.com is a WordPress network that runs many more thousands than that. I don't have the exact number on that, but we are one of the largest WordPress networks at the school. I know that there's other universities around in the area that are doing large WordPress networks like this as well. But it really comes down to making it simple for you to take one code base, maintain it, and then run hundreds and hundreds of sites in an environment that works for you. But at the end of the day, each one of those websites that you create on a WordPress network exists kind of in its own silo. It exists out there. You have one site, and another site, and another site, and another site, and another site, and they don't talk to each other. That means that any kind of content you create on one website, or any content you create on another website, knows nothing about any other sites on the network. And for that matter too, there's no way if you have a network of related websites or related content, so you have an entire network like a university or a school where all your websites are related, there's no way for you to go and turn around and say, well, I want to show content from this website on that website, or this website and that website very easily. But what if that didn't actually have to be the case? What if you could easily go and transcend those silos and boundaries that are created? And what if you could do this using the WordPress taxonomy system? What if you could create categories and tags that would span the entire breadth of the network, and then allow you to go and tag things cross-network, and then surface those things you just tagged on one part of the network, on another part of the network, and use that almost to drive related content or many other functionalities across the network. So no matter where in the network you happen to be, you can always be seeing tags and topics and categories that are related to what you're looking at. So, as I said before, so you have any kind of a network, tags, topics, categories, cross those across the boundaries, and go from there. We first took a look at this as an initiative from the External Relations Department who wanted to turn around and look for a better way to, for any kind of content that was on the news site or any department site in order to be surfaced on other sites around the school. So basically, what you could do is say, the nutrition source published an article on nutrition, and you were publishing something on the news, in the news about coffee or nutrition, those two would show up on each other and be cross-referenced and lumped into one category. We actually took a look around at a number of different solutions at the time to see if there was something that we could use to do this. And what we found out there was, well, pretty sparse. We found a deprecated plugin. We found a number of Stack Exchange articles kind of explaining a little bit about how to do this. WordPress had a plugin to kind of do this, but it ended up creating a shadow copy of every single piece of content published on another website. And then that shadow copy wasn't really maintained afterwards. If you updated something, it wouldn't really talk to it. And we also found a plugin that was doing a sync solution in order to basically take all the categories and tags that were individually input into one website and then sync them with all the other websites in the network. You can imagine after 2,000 websites running a sync is probably going to take a little while. So what we ended up doing is we ended up deciding to go and build our own. We ended up using a two-part plugin. And this plugin here, what it ends up being is a multi-site taxonomy plugin, which breaks down all the walls and ends up introducing cross-site tagging, cross-site tags, and taxonomies. And we ended up also building a presentation layer as well, which kind of includes our own customizations on top of it. We extended our own plugin as well, and built that into a separate plugin. The plugin that we have is available on GitHub, and that's a short link to it. I will bring it back up at the end, so you don't have to furiously write it down. I'll give you a second to write it down, but furiously copy it down. It's coming back, don't worry. So, how do we build this? Well, the first thing we did is we took a look at WordPress's taxonomy system. And we actually took a lot of code from that. We started with the WordPress taxonomy system, broke it out of WordPress, and then expanded it to allow for a network-wide taxonomy system. So a lot of the screens you're actually going to see in the next few slides look a lot like the WordPress taxonomy system, because they are. It is basically WordPress taxonomies extended to a massive level. We added screens to the UI to allow for multi-site tagging inside the network admin. We added network admin screens for editing. We added network-wide, a whole set of network-wide tables so you can track all the different tags and categories and taxonomies you create. And then we also built an entire front-end UI displaying kind of the, what you're familiar with, the archive pages, and all the front ends of components that go with it. Now to get into the real technical here, the database. This is the database schema for what we did. If any of you have looked at the WordPress database schema, it looks pretty familiar. This is the WordPress taxonomy, a term database. But you'll notice kind of one big difference with it. And that comes up with this. Because you're dealing with the with an entire network of blogs and taxonomies and tags, you need to also track the blog ID that you're talking about. So in the case of the multi-site terms and multi-term relationships, you have blog ID, then the post ID, and then the term ID, which is then related through the rest of the tables, same exact way that you're used to seeing inside of the rest of the WordPress taxonomy system and the WordPress taxonomy tables. So really, pretty much the same thing on the underline there, besides that one blog ID, which you'll need later on in order to figure out what blog you're on. We also created a vast structure on top of this. So all of the admin pages exist in the network admin, and they're at admin.php if you're familiar with the network admin, and the multi-site term list, and I have an asterisk there because whenever you can create your own custom taxonomy, it's going to append that to your multi-site term list underscore your own taxonomy. You're also getting a meta box on the post edit screen, which allows you, similar to categories and tags, to input that in. And you get a front end archive page at multi-taxo and whatever that archive page is. So if you have tags or topics or categories, maybe multi-taxo underscore, sorry, multi-taxo slash whatever you have for your topic. And then we also created something very, very similar for any of you who have actually dove in really deep to WP Multisite Query. We created a new class called WP Multisite Query. And that's basically very, very similar to WP Query, but instead of just querying for a single particular site, you're going to actually turn around and query across the entire network of that, of all your sites. So this class is very powerful right now, but it's also kind of in its infancy right now. So here's the admin. And for those of you who are familiar with WordPress admin and WordPress the categories and tags, that screenshot's going to look pretty familiar to you. As I mentioned before, we started with the WordPress core taxonomy code and extended it from there. So this screen here that you see there is pretty much that. Taxonomies are created using a very, very similar method to regular WordPress taxonomy creation. You make a call inside of any kind of plugin or theme, or most likely you do it in a plugin, because putting in a theme is not a good idea, to register multi-site taxonomy, where you create the taxonomy with the parameters that you're familiar with from regular registered taxonomy. This generates a taxonomy page in the network admin that looks pretty similar to what we see here. And it's pretty much similar to what you're used to seeing for regular WordPress categories and tags. And then adding a tag is as simple as just entering it in, hitting add new tag, and you've got your tag. And that's a tag that's now created across the entire network. We also built in right from the get-go because we realized that if you're managing a large-scale network, you probably don't want everybody on the network to be creating their own tags and own categories and own what taxonomies. That could get really messy really fast. So we built in roles and capabilities right from the get-go to actually restrict it down so that only the network admins can create taxonomies, and you can grant people the roles to create taxonomies and create tags and go from there. Or you have to use the ones this network admins define. Tagging content is pretty simple. In a familiar box to what you're used to seeing for regular tagging, you'll see all the taxonomies you just defined, topics, categories, campaigns, frontiers, the ones that we defined on the site here. screen, you can go right in and just add the tags that have been defined and drop them in same way exact way you used to for adding tags in a regular WordPress post. And because tags and categories, one's hierarchical, one's not, we also built in the option for you to have hierarchical taxonomies. So not only tags, but categories. And the UI that you're familiar with is also right there. And then again, if you're on a page with the tags, you can't actually see all the tags that have been defined on the site, so you're typing into the box trying to search for something, and it never really pops up, and so you get frustrated. Again, you have the choose for most used topics. That little button is there as well, so you see the big, large tag cloud. You can see what's popular, you can see what's been defined, you can see what's available, and then you can click on any of those and add them right into the page. Same exact way that WordPress tags work in the admin. Very familiar, because it pretty much is. On the front end then, once you've created your taxonomies, defined your tags, added them to the posts, on the front end, you get a page underneath that multi-taxo slug that is very, very similar to a regular WordPress archive page. The articles are displayed on the page in the order of, they're actually displayed by date, by default, that's one of the things you want to extend. And then also, once they're displayed on the page, the links that are on those articles actually take you back to the original post. So there's no shadow copies or nothing like that. It's actually querying across all the websites and taking you back to the original post, pulling in whatever image is from that original post, displaying the image there, so you get half a featured image, you get that image, you get the excerpt, you get the post title, and everything is and everything from there. Now, we built this with in mind with being able to extend it. And so what we ended up doing is we extended it ourselves. And when we started out, we put in filters, we put in hooks. Pretty much every single filter and hook that is in the regulated that you can use in taxonomy has a multi-site taxonomy component. And there are other ones that are available by default as well. We built the taxonomy system to be on posts, because posts are most likely what you're going to be doing and tagging, but you can extend it to pretty much any other custom post type. There's a filter for that. A couple of the things that we actually did to build in, and we actually did to extend it. We built a whole entire related relationship engine for the tag. So you can say, I have a tag. In this case here, I have a tag, Affordable Care Act, and that's related to health costs and health systems and health reform. And we were actually able to go in there and say, so you have a tag, you have its relationships, and then when you're viewing the archive page, we put a little bar across the top of the archive page where you can view the related tags for the tag that you're currently viewing, and we managed to surface more related articles that way. We also built a whole entire sidebar widget that was based upon this. So that sidebar widget looks like this, and basically what you have here is you have whatever that article is tagged with. So in this case, Affordable Care Act and Health Policy. And it displays to you the three most recent articles on the sidebar, and you can toggle between those tags and see all the articles, and then you can go down if you want to view more on this topic, you can click the more on this topic and go from there. And these are just a few of the customizations you can do with it. It's pretty much extendable to whatever you want to dream up here. And this was helpful for us because not only were we surfacing content then that was on a particular site or on the network, but we were also surfacing content across the entire network to anybody viewing our pages. So basically, we built a related content engine using this to show people everything, and we actually increase clicks across the whole entire site because of that. So, probably your question is, can you use this plugin on your site? And the answer is, yes, you can. Well, we have probably fixed the best in a website where you have a network of sites that have some kind of related content, or related topic, or related structure. Anytime you want to, if you have a network of sites that deals with a university or a school, or you have a network that is of sites that all share the same topic, then it fits pretty well because you're surfacing topics that are related across everything on one site. But you can pretty much use it for whatever you want. Installation, for those of you who are not familiar, the plugin is on GitHub, and that's the non-pretty URL for it. The short link from before will take you there. Grab the plugin from GitHub, install it into your WP Content Plugins folder, and then on the GitHub page, there's actually an example using the WordPress Multisite Taxonomy that kind of shows you just about how to go through what the parameters are. It's very, very similar to regular register taxonomy. Put in your parameters. Do that in a plugin, please. Don't do it in your theme. That's not good practice to do in the theme. And then once you have your taxonomies registered, you can go in and just start tagging your articles. As I mentioned before, the plugin is highly extendable via hooks and filters. It pretty much, as I said before, every single hook and filter that is in regular WordPress taxonomy has a multi-site taxonomy counterpart. So you can go in and you can filter this to any, you can extend this to allow multi-site tagging on any custom post type you've created. We have this done on our site. We have a number of different custom post types that we've extended it to. You can also build on additional features, like I showed before. You can build on, you can extend the presentation layer to work better with your theme. For those of you who have more advanced installs, it supports Composer. There are a few little limitations for it. As I mentioned before, this whole WP multi-site query part of it, that's still kind of in its infancy. It does a really good job. It could be made faster. It could take more parameter at this point, have some better sorting options. We have plans in the future to actually extend that to make it better, but if you want to download the plugin, dive in, and submit a pull request, you're more than welcome. We'll love to see it. The other one that's limited is if you mouse over any item on the archive page, pretty permalinks on that archive page are not supported, and that's an internal limitation that we ran into. We have yet to figure the way around it completely efficiently. But so if you mouse over a link on the archive page, you're not going to see the pretty permalink. You're going to see the WordPress ?P equals link, but that's not the worst thing at the end of the day. So what's next for us for this? Basically, we're going to take the front end support that we have built in and merge it into the rest of the plugin. Right now, we have the front end support kind of tied down a little bit to our theme, and so we want to break that and put it into the rest of the plugin here. We also want to extend the multi-site query, as I mentioned before, and we want to drop this whole thing into the WordPress repository so that you don't have to go into GitHub to find it. You can actually find it right in by searching inside your plugins and download and install without having to go to GitHub and do a man. So yeah, any questions for anybody at this point?
Thank you very much. That's great. One question I have is about tag bloat. Do you find, like, across your 2,000 sites, is there, you talk about permissions and you can prevent people from having tags, but how do you manage that, and do you have tag bloat?
So the question is about, like, how we manage tag bloating, and basically how we manage people from creating too many tags. So in our particular instance, we basically have the Office of External Relations is the office that's in charge of, like, all the news that comes out of the school. And in our particular instance, they are the only ones who can create tags. And so they actually have whiteboarding sessions every now and again where they go through and say, well, this tag is, you tagged on three articles, and if I go back to the slide here, you can actually see there is a count. of every single of the count column is preserved inside the tag. There you can see this tag is only used on two articles. Or wait a minute, this tag I have Affordable Care Act, and then I have Affordable Care Acts that I put it in twice. So you can see that, and you can delete the ones that are not there. But in our case, the load is handled by one office, or the people who are putting in the tags and managing it. And we don't really have that problem as of yet. They're doing a good job of it, but I can see that's something that would be, you open it up to everybody, that's something that could occur pretty quick.
I was just wondering, how do you identify related art that part of the whiteboard session you were talking about, or is this one
of the So how do we identify articles that are related to each other?
Yes, you said that you can show related articles in the sidebar.
So what we have right now is the related articles. Any article that is tagged with a particular piece of content is shown in that related for that particular tag in chronological order of what is the most recent. So that's what we have. That's the system we have right now for it. But then again, you can change that to basically whatever you want to put in there. So sort it out into any kind of order and surface it and display it in there for however you want. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay.
This is fascinating. Thank you so much for sharing it. And my question is about the performance. So I noticed, you have the blog ID with the multi-site taxonomy, so you know, okay, I only have articles in, X number of blogs, but, if you have articles across, 100 sites, how is the performance for that, and how do you guys handle performance concerns for that?
So, right now, it is actually doing a large-scale SQL query on the back end there. So WordPress has a function called switch to blog, which goes through and allows you to switch various different blogs across there. And that is a way that this could have done it, but switch to blog is, in order to switch between blogs, and once you do that a few times, you're getting into something enormously performance-heavy because every single time you switch between blogs, you're loading in all the assets. This is using an SQL query on the back end, a single select query that is grabbing from each of those blog IDs and grabbing each of the tables from the blog ID.
Is it just one join after join after join, or?
A little bit. There is a big SQL query. Some of them get a little bit big. We haven't noticed a huge performance impact across anything from there. It's one query. It's one query with a few joins in there. It could be optimized. It could be better. For what we have and for what we're doing, that seems to be working without a huge performance impact. We also have caching in there. We have, on our particular site, we have an object cache in place. We have Redis. But for this year, we built caching into the plugin as well to help with that performance as well. But it is a single SQL query, which is faster than using switch to blog, but it's still admittedly not the greatest. There's probably a better way, but with WordPress's database architecture schema, it's hard because you have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of tables to begin with. And so we need to get the image thumbnail, we need to get the excerpt, and we need to get the title of each post that we're doing. So it's a pretty big query once you actually break it down.
Is there a way to restrict your search across blogs? Like, for example, one blog that's not related, say, Science or Spark, you can have a search across different types of blogs.
Exclude a blog,
yeah.
And then one site query? That's not built in right now, but you could, you could put an exclude parameter in multi-site query and exclude it right out. I mean, that's one of the things, like, the multi-site query, we built it kind of looking at what the needs of us were, and if someone didn't want to use tagging on their website, we just don't tag their stuff. And that was kind of the agreed upon solution, but an exclude parameter in that would be a really simple way to do it. Exclude blog ID and just pass blog IDs to that at runtime. So yeah, that's a simple way to do it. As I said, multi-site query can be expanded. If you want to go and put a pull request in, we'd love to see it.
Hi, thank you. Does each individual site have the ability to edit a post? So if originally
post an article to the image attribute somehow. Could I go in and find a different team and put an image there?
If you are the content editor for that site, because every single site exists, if you edit a post on a particular site, and you're that content editor and has permission to edit posts on that site, you can change whatever you want, and whenever you change it, it's going to be, because every single query is happening in real time. So if you change the content, if you change the excerpt, if you change the image, if you change the title, that's immediately reflected in what's being shown up in the archive page in the list. So anytime you change something, it's in real time. So as long as you can edit a post, you can change it.
So another question about kind of some of the logistics of this. When you migrated into this system, I guess it's a multi-part question. Like, did you already have tags?
We had some tags, we had some taxonomies. We actually did a migration to get into this. We actually ended up writing a big, huge piece to get a big, huge migration plugin to migrate everything in, and using some WP CLI commands and some other part to get in.
Is that out there on the GitHub? That's
it's not out there on GitHub because a lot of it was custom to what we were doing at the time, and it probably wouldn't be applicable to anybody else.
Right.
Because if we had some previous architecture, we had some previous plugins extending some functionality that we built into that in order to merge everything into this. We don't have anything out there right now in terms of that. We just kind of did a big migration, mostly using CLI and an extra migration plugin.
Cool. I guess kind of related to that, I'm not sure if I understood, is this. For you then, there isn't regular tags living in parallel to this.
There are. So any kind of website has the ability to tag their content completely separate of this as well. So in this case here, there's tags and categories that are living on every single website. If they have a blog on their website, they can go through and they can tag their blog with whatever they want. They can tag that blog post with tags that match exactly what they put into the multi-site tags as well. So the two are living in parallel. We use multi-tagging mainly to surface content across the entire network as one big huge network, and then show it on that entire, show it across. So if you go to our website, you'll see it says like explore by topic, and we have a big topic page that shows, okay, so you have a topic of Affordable Care Act, and a topic of nutrition, and a topic of coffee, the topic of carbohydrates, and then if you click on that, you're getting in aggregated content from across the entire school. But if you go to the nutrition source and you look at their articles tagged coffee, you're just going to get the ones that are tagged coffee on their site individually, unless you go to the full-on recombinant site tag.
So just a quick follow-up to that, then. In your related content widget, are you surfacing the local and the network?
No, we're only surfacing the network and the related content. You can still add the local widgets as well, and have two if you want. We're just surfacing the top level ones, assuming that if you want to have it a surface in there, put it, if you want to just use that as your own, just put it in there, and or then put two widgets on the page. So, anyone else? Questions, thoughts?
What about security issues with it? Suddenly everyone has access to everyone else's content on some level.
You don't have access to everyone else's content per se. You can't edit other people's tags, other people's content. You are still limited down to tagging things that are on a single site that you have access to, and then we have the limiter in place there for creating multi-site tags as well. So you don't actually have access to the content itself per se. What you can do is if you have access to a particular website, you have access to tag content on that particular site, you can go in and you can tag things, multi-tag things, and then that gets surfaced to the top. But if someone from one other site can't go in and change or affect anything that someone else has done. So it's aggregating everything, but you can't jump. You can't jump the boundaries, you can just push things to the central location.
Is it fair to assume then that multi-site query honors posts that are private or password protected?
Yes. Yep, it honors that. If you can see them, it'll show you them, but if not, then
plus this guy mentioned this thing for security. Okay. See the potential problem, depends where you will use it. If one person imagine create a tax and manage a tax, and another person use this tax on their website, and they tag their content. But this person who manages the tag can rename the original tag. And what happened with this content that they already tagged with the original tag?
If you rename a tag, yes, then the content with the original tag, same exact way as in WordPress, if you go in and rename a tag, you're going to, that tag is going to change. Everything that's tagged with that is going to still be tagged with it. That's the same exact way that WordPress does handles tags right now. So yeah, it's kind of a shortcoming. You can create an infinite number of tags, so there really isn't a need to rename the tag. But yeah, that could be a problem if someone went in and actually turned air pollution into alcohol.
Yeah.
Then everything that was tagged air pollution is now tagged alcohol. And
so a lot of people will be involved, like it's like a huge network, not just
only the people who have access to edit and manage tags are the ones who can go in and actually change things. So it's not like every single site publisher can go in and change tags around willy-nilly. It's basically if you have the permission to add tags, edit tags, edit the multi-site tags, then you can go in and do that. The thought being that if it's restricted down to a small enough group of users, that if those trusted users who are editing, actually managing editing the tags, someone isn't going to do that. And then everyone else on the network has the ability to use those tags that are created and edited and managed, but not necessarily change or edit or update them. They can just utilize them and go from there. So if let's say you have five people who are able to go in and edit tags and 500 people who can use them, the chance that one of those five people who is going to go in and make a random change to any of those tags is pretty small. And then at that point, one of the other people can go, so, about that change from air pollution to alcohol.
Yeah, and I just wanted to use it in some kind of network like Reddit style, where people can create the topics websites, and there's like user-generated content, and some moderators that you never saw there somewhere in the internet.
So people couldn't go through and change the tags that are created; they could just use them. In which case you run into the problem with any kind of tagging, where if you create the tag, if someone just goes through and tags their article with every single one of these tags just because they're trying to spam game the system, I mean that's something that's going to happen no matter what, and that's where you have the moderators come in and step in and say no. But there isn't anything to prevent any kind of system from tags, or people can tag their own stuff. There isn't anything besides the network where you're just a slap on the wrist to say don't do that.
Yeah, I just imagine you have a cool, as you mentioned, that we can extend your plugin on that kind of event. Someone changed the name of original tag,
yep.
Send like a
there's a there for on tag change. You can send an email if someone renames a tag, you can have us send an email. There's an on change hook, there's all those hooks.
Yeah, and so you decide what to do to
exactly.
Yeah,
I mean, that's something that you can do. So, yeah. All right. I think we are out of time. If you have any other questions or anyone want to follow up, I'll be out front. The next people need to send a present here. So.